The Miracle of dMEK Surgery for Cornea Transplantation. In 1997, when I started practicing ophthalmology, if a patient had worsening vision due to Fuch's corneal dystrophy, that individual was confronted with the following journey. Number one, the need for a full thickness cornea transplant. Two, 12 to 18 months of blurred vision until all sutures were removed and the cornea stabilized. Three, long-term increased risk of damage to the eye by accidental trauma. Four, unpredictable refractive outcomes, which would obviate the ability of the surgeon and patient to have any expectation of achieving clear vision without glasses with a single procedure. Five, long-term risk of graft rejection. Six, if the patient wanted to have an excellent visual outcome without glasses, then they would need to expect several procedures over a two-year span to achieve such a result. Lastly, confronted with these variables, ophthalmologists were very cautious and conservative about treating these patients and would delay performing surgery for as long as they and the patients could wait because we knew the visual recovery process was slow and complex. Fast forward to 2019. Here, our patient has a visually significant cataract and Fuch's dystrophy. She is bothered by overall blurred vision from her right eye and glare at night with oncoming headlights. Her preoperative vision, uncorrected, 20/100 far away, and J10, which is 20/100 close up. Her refraction on her right eye is that she is hyperopic and has a best corrected vision of 20/25, and she has glare to 20/400 on that right eye. After a thorough discussion of the pros and cons of dSEC versus dMEK, she had dSEC performed on her left eye in 2016, and the type of lens that she could select, we ultimately elected to perform combined dMEK surgery with placement of a Symphony extended depth of focus lens to her right eye. What we are showing are the three phases of her treatment. On March 11th, here we are, removing her cataract, then placing a Symphony lens implant like we do routinely. Next, we mark the cornea, then remove the abnormal corneal endothelium. Because her cornea diameter is 11.7 millimeters, we elected to place a 7.75 millimeter diameter dMEK donor. We removed a 7.75 millimeter diameter area of her corneal endothelium. Next, we inserted the donor corneal endothelium and decimase membrane that had been pre-cut, pre-marked with an S stamp, and then preloaded into a modified Jones tube. Of note, the initial cataract surgery primary incision has been widened from 2.8 millimeters to 3.0 millimeters to facilitate easy insertion of the tip of the Jones tube. The donor corneal tissue is then methodically centered and then unfolded within the anterior chamber. This process is the most challenging aspect of dMEK surgery. After gentle tissue manipulation that involves adjustments to the anterior chamber depth, rotating the graft to ensure that it is not going to unfold upside down, and moving the donor scroll without actually ever touching it directly, which would destroy donor corneal endothelial cells, we are ultimately able to align the donor tissue with our area of previously trephinated corneal endothelium, then use air to expand and push the donor tissue against the patient's cornea. We then wait 5 to 10 minutes to allow the two layers to adhere to one another. On March 20th, here is the donor cornea as seen 9 days after surgery. The uncorrected vision is 20/60 far and J16 near, which is 20/200 near. Her refraction is plano with 1.5 diopters of astigmatism, allowing 20/60 vision. We can see that the inferior cornea is clear while the superior cornea is still edematous. Upon closer inspection, the donor dMEK tissue can be seen not adhering to the patient's cornea in the area of corneal edema, which is limiting this patient's vision 1 week postoperatively. Note the S stamp on the donor tissue layer. It is not in apposition with the patient's cornea in the superior half of the cornea, and therefore the patient's cornea is cloudy and edematous, which is limiting her vision. We elect to place additional air into the anterior chamber in the exam lane using a 30-gauge needle. This is the appearance of the eye immediately after placement of additional air. We can see that the S stamp that is marked on the donor cornea is now in apposition with the patient's cornea. We ensure that the patient has a normal intraocular pressure and then send her home with the air bubble in place to push the donor tissue against the patient's cornea. On March 21st, here is the patient's cornea the next day, now 10 days after surgery. We can now see that the air bubble is doing what we hoped that it would do, pushing the donor against the patient's cornea, allowing the patient's cornea to clear. On March 28th, here's the patient's cornea 1 week later. The patient's vision, uncorrected, is 20/25 far away, and J4, which is 20/50 near. Her refraction is minus 0.75, with 1 diopter of astigmatism, correcting to 20/20. It should be noted that in our preoperative calculations, we anticipated and predicted that her refraction would be between minus a quarter and minus a half. In fact, we hit our refractive target. The cornea is now almost completely clear, and if we did not see the S stamp or the single suture, it would be difficult to see microscopically that the patient had even had any surgery. dMEK corneas look like young corneas that are pristine. Cornea transplantation has evolved quite a bit over the past 20 years. Starting my career, I never imagined that we would be transplanting individual layers of corneal tissue that would allow a refractive surgery type result within weeks. Ultimately, this patient will have as good a result within 1 to 2 months as a patient who has a normal cornea and is seeking elective eye surgery purely for reduced spectacle dependence. dMEK surgery makes refractive surgery possible. Thank you for your time and attention. Have a wonderful day.